Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Anyone have come to order, and I'd like to ask Commissioner Lashley if he would have our invocation.
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time thanking you for all that you do in our lives. We ask you to continue to bless this nation, bless our people. We ask you for guidance in everything that we say and do tonight, that we will do what the people have us to do. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, I'll start with the public comments. Before I do, I want to just make everybody aware that this is 3 minutes on the public comments, and there will be no other comments tonight from the public unless if you want to be on the public comments, you can tell me now, and I'll add your name to this. So I just want to reiterate that tonight. So if you want to make them, you can make them now. Okay, the first is David Blair.
Good evening.
Good evening.
How y'all doing tonight? At the board's August 16th meeting, the county attorney and a couple of commissioners offered comments that made me wonder whether they've actually read the June 2nd letter announcing the Department of Justice's investigation of our sheriff. The county attorney claimed, and the chairwoman echoed, that we have not been told what we've done wrong. The county attorney further asserted that every deputy in our sheriff's office has been accused of racial profiling. These statements deviate so far from the content of the June 2nd letter that it would be charitable to characterize them as the result of mere ignorance, and reasonable to conclude that they're intended to create unnecessary confusion. This is an investigation, not a trial. There have been no former accusations, no charges or lawsuits filed, and no arrests made. We haven't been informed of any wrongdoing because the investigators have not determined that there has been any. That's the point of an investigation, to find out. Which brings me to the most amazing thing about the reactions of those who oppose this investigation. They seem to have already concluded that it will uncover criminal malfeasance. I have no idea what leads them to prejudge its outcome in this way. In the June 2nd letter, the DOJ indicates no such prejudice, plainly stating we have not reached any conclusions about the subject matter of the investigation. Commissioner Sutton offered strong support for resistance. I find his position thoroughly irresponsible, as the June 2nd letter notes that similar investigations have been resolved in cooperation with the target entities without resort to contested litigation. The recent lawsuit filed by the DOJ against Maricopa County, Arizona, should cause us all to pause and consider whether we want to waste taxpayer dollars in a doomed effort to cover up our sheriff's activities. This is especially true in light of the rather mild consequences outlined in the June 2nd letter. Should systemic violations of constitutional or federal rights be uncovered in a climate of cooperation, the DOJ says, we will inform you of the findings and attempt to work with Alamance County to remedy any such violations. In addition, we will identify any assistance the United States may be able to provide in correcting the deficiencies. In short, if, as has been so often been asserted, we have nothing to hide, then we have nothing to fear from this investigation. However, if the effort to resist turns out to be an attempt to cover up violations of civil and/or criminal law, we can be assured that those efforts will fail and that we will face the consequences not just of the underlying violations, but of any attempts to obstruct the investigators. Again, I urge you to offer your full and complete support of this investigation so that any deficiency discovered might be readily resolved in a way that prevents taxpayer dollars from being wasted in a foolish effort to obstruct justice. Thank you.
Mr. Blair, you've referenced my name, and I wasn't going to ask you any questions. What position did you gather that I put out there on the date? On the date that you specified?
Yes, on August 16th meeting during the commissioner comments sections. You can look at the tape.
I have it.
You said we should resist this investigation. That's a paraphrase of your remarks, but that's very close.
I find that hard to believe.
That's what you said.
I will go back and look at it, and it's obvious you said paraphrase, so we'll just see exactly what those words were.
It's very
maybe my definition of what I meant by that will extremely
if
be
you'd
different
like to clarify
from yours.
What you meant. Please take this
opportunity. As our opinions differ on what we should do with illegal immigrants in this country, I expect my comments are definitely different from your interpretation of them. So we'll find out.
The question of this investigation, the matter of this investigation, has nothing to do with what we, with federal policy regarding immigration. It has to do with federal policy regarding proper policing.
Okay. That is, are you through, Mr. Sutton?
No, not yet. I haven't ever stated resist. I made the statement that there should be checks and balances between any government agency when it pursues information from another. And if you consider that trying to evade a proper investigation, then, you know, our definition of how to interpret and analyze people's statements are totally different. But I will go back and look at that August 16th, and I guarantee you I did not say stonewall it. And that's what you're trying to insinuate.
You did not use the word stonewall.
Well,
you said,
you're close enough.
I do think we should resist this investigation.
You're close enough.
Thank you.
We'll find out. And we'll see if you want to continue the debate at the next meeting.
Oh, this will go on.
Good. So, and I will be here to give it back, as long as the public gives me that right.
I look forward to it.
I love it, too.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, Mr. Oakes, John Oakes.
Commissioners, good evening. My name is John Oakes. I live at 2266 Glenkirk Drive in Burlington. I'm here before you this evening in reference to the investigation of our sheriff and our sheriff's department by the Department of Justice. Only after much thought and consideration, and after doing my own due diligence surrounding this investigation. I am just an average citizen that has become frustrated with what's going on in our county and country at a local, state, and national level. I also don't like public speaking. I have decided to no longer just remain silent when issues arise that I feel are important or unjust. Specifically tonight, I'm here to discuss this investigation by the DOJ into our sheriff and sheriff's department, and the alleged allegations made by the local group Fairness Alamance, its members suggesting improper behavior by our sheriff and county attorney toward illegal immigrants. I became aware of this investigation when I was learning about the murder of an Alamance County resident by an alleged illegal immigrant. Personally, I have concluded that this investigation is politically motivated. I think that it is important that everyone know that I am a registered independent voter, and I have no axe to grind with anyone personally in reference to this issue. Personally, I don't know Sheriff Johnson. I don't know our county attorney, Mr. Albright, or anyone to my knowledge associated with Fairness Alamance Group. But here's what I do know. I think it's disgraceful for anyone to repeatedly come before our county commissioners and lecture them on what is and isn't appropriate response by our county attorney and our sheriff in reference to this investigation. I suggest that anyone that concludes that an investigation by our federal government, such as the DOJ, is beyond reproach and only benign and politically motivated is extremely naive and at best and at worst is incompetent. For anyone to suggest that because our county attorney and sheriff who are handling this matter in a manner that they have decided is in the best interest of our county and its employees is somehow evidence of improper behavior and correlates with being guilty of improper behavior is truly misguided and irrational, no matter how sincere their intentions. I would like to publicly request that Mr. Blair, who is very articulate and I have concluded is an educated man, or any member from the Fairness Alamance Group or anyone from the general public that has any evidence to suggest illegal or just improper behavior by our Sheriff's Department in reference to illegal immigrants being mistreated or profiled, please present that information privately to our sheriff and to Mr. Albright, our county attorney. If after discussing this matter with them privately, they are not satisfied with their efforts, I would encourage them to present their information publicly, during future public county commissioner meetings so that rational and honest people can come to their own conclusions concerning this matter. May I have 30 seconds? I think it is not only important but essential that our county commissioners trust our sheriff and county attorney in their efforts in making decisions on behalf of our county until you have reasons or proof not to trust them or question their integrity. Isn't that reasonable? Isn't that fair? I would encourage you to discontinue this political tug of war that I am confident 80% or more of our citizens have concluded is nothing more than an issue being used to politically attack our sheriff and county attorney and is politically motivated by people who are only interested in changing laws that have traditionally protected our citizens. Thank you for your consideration.
Amen.
Thank you. Okay, that's all of our public comments. At this time, I will close the public comment session, and we will have a public hearing on the subdivision ordinance waiver request. At this time, I'll open the public hearing. Mr. Martin.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet a fairly substantial stack of information there. What you have before you is a subdivision waiver request for the River Mill Village in Saxbahal. Just to kind of give you some brief background on this, this is the redevelopment of the mill itself into condominiums, both residential and commercial condominiums. There will be 29 residential condominium units and 5 new commercial units, and the applicant is also requesting the waiver for the existing 5 that are being rented out, and this is so that these can be deeded separately. So it is falling in as a planned unit development, which requires a waiver under the subdivision ordinance. In the summer of 2010, a site plan for the proposed redevelopment was left with the planning department for review. After discussion with the developer, staff indicated that the proposed development would classify as a planned unit development, as specified under the subdivision ordinance. The developer was informed of the need to apply for a subdivision waiver, and on July 26th, an application was filed with myself. The planning board has reviewed this application. They reviewed it at their meeting on August 12, 2010, and voted unanimously to recommend approval of the request. What you should have in here, in addition to the actual permit application itself, you should have some renderings and drawings of the proposed development and the footprint of the individual condominium units. With that, I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time, as well the developer, and I believe their architect are here this evening. Mr. Mac Williams is here as well to take questions from you all. Or, not Mac Williams, Mac Jordan, wrong Mac.
So. I call him John.
That's John.
That's John.
Mac's
over there, too. Does anybody have any questions from the audience concerning this? I have looked at those pictures. They look good.
I have been down and looked at that, and it is a beautiful job, the way they're doing it. All the workmanship is first class. It is really a nice setup.
Are there any comments from the, any more? None from the audience, evidently. Any more from the board? Okay. If not, at this time, I will close the public hearing and we'll entertain a motion to accept this waiver.
That motion.
I have a motion on the floor.
I'll second.
Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Thank you. Okay. The next thing is the probation office site review, and Mr. Burgess is going to talk about it before Mr. Russell comes up.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. On April 5th of this year, the Board of Commissioners authorized the county to contract with Allie Williams, Carmen, and King to conduct a site analysis of potential locations for a modular building to be used for probation services. What brought this about is the policy with the state previously was that the state would pay for some of the lease space for probation services. There are currently 2 locations. Previously, the county had paid the lease on one of the locations, and the state had paid the lease on the other one. A change in state policy, it may have been state law, required the county to pay all of that lease, those lease payments, which in this current year's budget is over $137,000. So we started looking at what options did we have. We would prefer not to pay lease payments, but to actually be able to put that into a facility that we one day may own. So we started looking at what would be the most economical way in which to do that, and a modular unit was something that we had looked at.
try to construct a modular facility to house probation services. So at that meeting on the April 5th, the board did approve for Allie Williams, Carmen, and King to do a site analysis of several different locations to see which one would be the most appropriate location for that facility and also to provide cost estimates as to what that would cost. At this time, we have Darrell Russell with us with Allie Williams, and he will go over his findings. And then once he finishes, I'll come back up and request approval on several items which you have on the memo that you have in your agenda packet. So thank you.
Well, good evening, Chair Massey and Commissioner.
Good evening.
I'm glad to be here this evening.
Mr. Russell.
I hope you have a copy of our report.
And we do.
I will not read this verbatim. I'll summarize. That's okay.
Be fine.
We did look at three possible sites for probation services. I'll refer to site one. It's located off of Crescent Square Drive in Graham. It's directly across from the entrance to Department of Motor Vehicles office where we go get our driver's license. That site is owned by NC Department of Transportation. Site two is on Martin Street. It is beside the existing county offices of Family Justice Center. That's in Burlington. That site is owned by the county. We also looked at site number three. It's on Prison Camp Road and is actually behind the existing county prison annex. And that site is owned by the DOT, and the county currently has a lease arrangement for that site. All sites are currently zoned properly for this use, so we wouldn't get into any zoning issues if we decide to move forward. We prepared a site plan for each site. They're included in the rear of this report as exhibits 1, 2, 3. A fairly detailed site that looks at how each site could be used to include 10,000 square feet for the office and then about 150 parking spaces. So that does add up to a good sized tract of land for that purpose. We then took each site and based on the layout, we've done a detailed cost estimate for grading, paving, water, sewer. We've included an estimate for the offices itself, modular office. And then we've totalized those. And on page 5 is really a summary of the cost. And you'll note that site number 3 had the lowest estimate of probable cost at just a little over $1 million, actually $1,320. Site 2 was a little more than that, of $1,016,400. And site 2 was $1,128,000. So site 3 did end up having the lowest estimate of probable cost. So based on our analysis, if the county does decide to move forward with this, then we would recommend that you pursue site number 3 on Prison Camp Road. And if you do, this would be subject to a final approval by the DOT because they currently own it, and they would need to do some lease amendment to incorporate this. So, do you have any questions?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm looking at site 3, okay, and under land costs, we have a zero, but will we be leasing that land? We'll put a building on it, but we'll lease that land forever and ever, and at what cost?
I do not know what the lease arrangements would be if it's a significant sum.
Mr. Burgess,
can
answer that.
I don't believe we lease the current prison site, but there's a cost to the county.
Okay.
For that. So we have gotten preliminary approval from DOT to lease additional property and place this on that site. And my assumption is at this point, until we see the final lease, that it will be at no cost.
Well,
that's what I had thought.
What's the typical terms of a lease like that?
Usually $1 a year, 50 years.
I mean, for 50 years, okay.
That's usually typical long-term leases that they would be looking at.
Right.
And that's the thing also about going with a modular that we looked at If we had to ever move the building, that can be done also.
Just want some clarification.
Good question.
Yes. Any more questions from the board?
Design service, what would that entail for $83,000?
That includes the cost to design the site work. It's, as you'll notice from each site, there's considerable grading and paving and stormwater management. So it includes the engineering that relates to the site.
That doesn't go into site work?
No. No, I had that as a separate item. And then it also includes architect fees that relate to the design of the modular. There's a certain amount of effort needed up front related to that. It also includes periodic inspection and construction administration. All of that is included in the design. Item D, yes.
And contingencies.
Contingency is something that we like to include in projects to cover such things as if we hit unsuitable soil on a site, if we hit rock. We have not done any soil borings at any site to know what's below ground. So we do like to include and recommend that owners include a contingency item for unknown, unforeseen conditions.
So we wouldn't necessarily be paying $1,300,000?
It may be less than that. That's correct.
This is max.
I hope it would be.
Well, good thing about the modular, that's a pretty definite cost there, right, other than the setup.
That's correct.
The $450,000.
That includes the setup, yes.
Any more questions?
There's no fill on that site. I noticed one of them, you said there was some fill dirt before they cut the food in.
Let's see, site number one did need haul in fill.
So y'all already done some boring to test?
Well, no, but we did look at it enough to see that it's going to need some haul in material.
Must have seen the back on that site.
Yes, yes.
Because I read by there, could look it down.
And the other two sites look, the topography looked pretty good, that we shouldn't have to do any haul in.
Anything else? And Mr. Birch,
thank you.
Mr. Birch, please stress the fact that what we're paying now, I don't know if the people understood that we're already paying.
I think in this year's budget, or actually what we're actually making in payments this year, is $137,847.60 for this current budget year.
Per year.
Per year.
Right.
So what we want to do is be able to take that money, put it towards funding this project, and eventually we will not have that yearly cost.
Exactly.
So
that's what I wanted the people to understand.
We're trying to get out of leasing properties if we can.
How that worked.
What's the differential in debt service currently versus debt service for the new, for the improvements?
I'm not sure I understand.
I mean, we're going to have to pay for the improvements, right?
We would, yes. The $1 million, there's a couple of different options on that. One is borrowing the money,
right,
and then using part of the yearly lease payments to repay the loan with. That would be one option. Another option would be, or there are a couple of other options that we're looking at, whether, you know, if revenues came in more this year than what we anticipate, that could be a possibility. We use those revenues. And then the other would be, you know, you could use fund balance and then just repay your fund balance with those lease payments each year to replenish that money. So we're looking at those different kinds of options to see which would be the best.
My point is, I don't think we need to be saying we're going to raise taxes to take care of this.
No,
that's because, right.
Because make sure it's not mentioned.
Tim, just a quick question on, on the leases that we have already with other buildings. Are we under any obligations under those?
Those would, if I'm not mistaken, I think those expire about the time that we're wanting to get this modular up and running. So, yes, the timing should be right on that. Our goal is next July 1st is our goal that we're shooting for, and I think that's about the time the leases expire, current leases.
And the state's willing to work with us on this. They're aware that we're looking at this so that there's no problem.
Does the state own those buildings?
No, sorry, they're private.
But they kind of have a say-so in making sure that the buildings provide whatever their requirements, meet their requirements as far as for offices for probation services.
And that's part of the nice thing about this is to combine them both under one roof. You know, they also had some discussion. One of the offices is located in Burlington, is bringing it closer in town. to be all under one roof, and that's part of the design services that they'll provide, is helping to design the 10,000 square feet that we work with the Department of Corrections and Jeff Allen to make sure we're giving them a facility that'll meet their needs as well.
And we have been keeping Jeff, the supervisor, Jeff Allen, supervisor of probation, sir, we have been keeping him updated on what's been going on, and he'll be heavily involved in the process of designing the unit to make sure it meets their needs.
So. Well, Tim, do we have any idea what the payments would be yearly for this $1 million?
Well, it depends on which route we go, and it depends on whether, well, it could be anywhere from, I'd say, 8 to 13 years, depending on different options to pay it back, yes.
Do you have any idea what the amount would be?
Well, it's going to be the $1 million. Interest rates, we got some interest rates, I think, for 7 years was 2.3%, but if you pay it off in 7 years, you're going above what your lease payments are. So you'd have to get it probably, if you're going to use your lease payments to pay your debt service, you're going to get up at least probably to the 10-year period.
So in other words, we're going to pay $137,000 per year.
Right. Instead of paying that into lease payments, we'll be paying it into debt payments. And eventually, that's right, and eventually that'll be paid off. And then we'll have to see whether we want to use part of that lease payment for utilities or whether we just want our budget to absorb the utility payments from somewhere else. So those are things we'll, once we get a firm plan in place, we'll come back and bring that to you.
Well, we got to put them somewhere because the state's already told us that, right?
Well, no, the reason that what's motivated us to move towards this is because we used to only pay for about half of their rental space and paid for the other half.
Right.
Approximately a year ago, the state changed their...
Right, this budget year is when we had to pick up an additional $75,000
in
lease payments.
And so that's kind of what motivated us to find a way.
So basically, we got to do it just about. I mean, we got to do something about it.
To me, it makes sense. It's a smart move. If it's kind of like buying a house, kind of stupid to pay rent when you can buy a lot cheaper or at the same price.
That's right.
I make the motion that we accept that.
For site three.
Site three.
Yeah, and there's three things that I'd like to ask the board, that we move forward with the concept of doing a modular, and then we'll, of course, issue requests for proposals from different companies like we did with the Pleasant Grove modular. Mm-hmm. And then also on the financing issue, too, we'll do that. And then also to approve the site, which was site three, mm-hmm. Prison Camp Road site, as the site to move forward on. And then also authorize us to enter into contract negotiations with Allie Williams, Carmen, and King for the services that are mentioned in the memo there. Okay. And then we would bring back at a future meeting their contract for y'all to approve.
Do we need to do them one at a time, or can we just bundle it?
I think you can bundle it. Unless there's any changes to what... Tim's presented.
Okay. I have a motion on the floor already. Can we accept this bundle and for everything that Mr. Burgess has just said and Ms. Jones has that recorded? And I have a second from Mr. Boswell, and this time your motion, everybody votes.
So moved.
All right. It's on the floor.
I'm good.
Okay. I say aye.
Aye.
No opposed.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Okay, the next thing is the watershed. It's Jason.
Madam Chair and Commissioners, you should have in your packet a memorandum from me regarding the Hall River watershed reclassification. You may recall back in, I believe it was in June, I spoke to you all at that time about the state wanting to do a reclassification of the Hall River watershed in response to the emergency intake that was put in by the city of Greensboro on the Hall River in northeast Guilford County. This would essentially create a new watershed area in the county as a small portion between Jug House, roughly the Jug House Road area north to the county line and east to roughly Highway 87. Relatively small area in Alamance County. At that time, the planning board had directed me to work with, recommended directing me to work with the other affected municipalities and counties, as well as the Piedmont Triad Council of Governments. And in June, we started working with them, particularly Rockingham and Guilford County, as they were fairly heavily impacted by this. As a result of those discussions, the state has dropped initially. They wanted to do a WS3 classification, which was a more restrictive reclassification, and has countered with a WS4 reclassification. Anytime that there is an intake put in, according to state law, administrative code, they have to reclassify the watershed area. The Jordan Lake rules essentially created all of Alamance County as a WS5 watershed, anything that was not covered with watershed area. This would require an additional reclassification, so this is coming down a step to WS4 instead of WS3. In my memo, I discuss here the real-world application in real-world terms. How is this going to affect the property owner there? WS4 requires a minimum lot size of 0.5 acre or 24% built upon limitations, and built upon areas anything impervious to water, concrete buildings, gravel, that sort of thing. The minimum lot size for the county, if the lot is served by well and septic, is currently 30,000 square feet, or roughly 0.69 acres, 0.7 acres. So we already would meet that requirement. So in essence, it really would not have a big impact on the property owners. It would, however, subject the properties within that new watershed area to some land use restrictions that are in the watershed ordinance. And as part of the packet, I also included, in addition to the letter, the recommendation of support, resolution of support, a listing of the restrictions under the balance of watershed area of the watershed ordinance. And you see the prohibited uses specifically are sites for land application of residuals, petroleum contaminated soils, discharging landfills, and storage of hazardous materials unless a spill containment plan is obtained through the fire marshal's office. As part of the process, resolutions of support are requested from the jurisdictions that will have their land use and density requirements affected by the changes in local policy. I did take this to the planning board on August 12th. The planning board voted unanimously to recommend approval of this. I've also invited tonight Cy Stober from the Piedmont Triad Council of Governments, and I would like to publicly thank Cy for his hard work on this matter and discussing this with the state. The reclassification the state originally wanted to do would be basically, it would had a big effect because the minimum lot size would have went up to 1 acre. Built upon areas would have been roughly 12%, I believe, under WS3. So this represents the least change possible.
So it's now 0.69 acres, right?
That is the minimum lot size that we already have.
Okay.
So that's we already meet the requirement.
Okay. Okay, good.
And I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time.
Okay. Any questions?
Are they using this pump site yet? I assume they're not.
I don't believe Greensboro has pulled water from it. Sure.
Yes, sir. They have this.
Good evening. The city of Greensboro put this emergency water intake in response to the drought of 2002. The intake was put in with permission from the Department or Division of Environmental Health at the state level in 2003. They drew from it once that year. They drew from it multiple times during the drought of 2007. It is for emergency intake purposes only. They have a written agreement with the State Department of Environment and Natural Resources under the conditions in which they can draw water from the Haw River for emergency purposes. Basically, it limits them to only drawing water from the Haw during the winter in response to rebalance their reservoirs following a drought summer. And so that's what they did in winter 2007-2008, as far as I know. Okay. They tried to minimize their use of this emergency water intake, and especially with Randaman Lake coming online, this will likely be very infrequently used, if ever.
I hope they're smart enough to make sure that somebody don't steal the copper wires like they did before.
Under this economy, I would hope so as well. Yes, sir.
Could I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it under emergency use? What would they consider emergency?
A drought conditions, ma'am.
It's drought.
Severe drought. I'm not sure exactly what the stipulations are within the agreement they have with the state, but moderate drought is not a severe enough condition for the city, I believe. to draw water from the Haw River. It basically needs to be a drought on the scale, historic drought on the scale that we saw in 2002 or 2007.
Any more questions?
If I can add just one more thing, I did want to explain as well that this reclassification would have to come from the state, and they will have to hold public hearings on this issue. And I believe, from what I've been told, we're looking at about a year probably before public hearings would start, and I would think maybe, 2 to 3 years before actual implementation.
Yes.
It's still on down the line a little bit. At this point, the state is just requesting support moving forward.
To do the resolution.
Yeah, if the board wishes to do that, yes.
Okay, at this time, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. And are you not up next?
I think I am.
I think you're here in June, don't you?
Permanent residence.
My feet are growing to the floor.
What can I say?
Okay, and you also should have in your packet another memorandum from me regarding the CDBG Economic Recovery Program grant application. Last summer, the county submitted a letter of interest to the North Carolina Division of Community Assistance to apply for a grant in the amount of $500,000 with no matching requirement, local matching funds required under the North Carolina Community Development Block Grant Economic Recovery Program as provided by HUD. The purpose of the grant is, just like our scattered sites housing grant, is to do housing repair. And this would be rehabilitation on 10 low to moderate income homes and emergency repairs on 8 low to moderate income homes. At that time, the state chose not to fund the county's request, but has recently invited the county to resubmit this request, to submit a formal application this year for the funding. As part of the process, we need to hold a public hearing before we can actually send in the application. Staff recommends setting a public hearing for the next meeting on September 20th, 2010 at 7 p.m.
Have you targeted any of these houses yet?
Basically,
or any of the area that you think
might be? How housing grants work, we have maintained a waiting list on that, which we've never gotten caught up. The last time I saw the list, it was roughly 67 to 70 houses that are still waiting on it. But this year with this, we'll be able to do 18 houses with this grant if we are awarded it. We're scheduled to get awarded $400,000 already for the scattered sites grant, which we typically do about 8 to 10 houses with that. And then we also, last year, were awarded the single family rehab grant through the North Carolina Housing Finance Agency, which we were able to do probably about another 8 to 10. So I think we'll be able to do a nice dent in that waiting list with these grants. And of course, I know we are trying to solicit local builders and contractors, get them on direct solicitation to get this out to them.
Well, thank you, Tommy. You had one.
We have one that has bid and has been awarded, and we'd love to have more of them. Contact me to get on the list. So.
Okay, any more questions of Mr. Martin?
Maybe unrelated, but maybe related. Did they ever decide what caused the fish kill that was so bad about a month ago?
I have not heard if there was ever any determination on that. You're talking about the not in Jordan.
Well, no. Haw River coming from Guilford Inn.
Right.
Yeah.
I have not heard anything on that.
Maybe
you
have any comment? Yes, sir. The Division of Water Quality followed that up too late. They essentially dropped the ball on that case. The reporting happened 2 days after the kill. The division got out there 2 days later. It was too late to do the forensics that they needed to do to track that down. They don't have an idea. Under the extreme heat conditions of the summer, there's some speculation that it was simply extreme heat and low oxygen levels, but there's no confidence behind that statement. That's pure speculation, and the division wasn't able to respond in time to actually investigate the matter.
Okay, any more questions? At this time, I'll entertain a motion to set the public hearing for September the 20th, 2010.
So moved.
I have a second. Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed. Are you next again, Jeff?
No, ma'am.
I believe we got a budget amendment is next from the Health Department.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Commissioners. We've been awarded a $1,300 grant from the North Carolina Division of Public Health Chronic Disease and Injury Branch. The purpose of this grant is to enhance our local asthma prevention efforts. And as you all may recall, if you've been around town, you've seen the flags flying for green and yellow and orange air quality days. That's what we would expand that, as well as getting like the magnets that we're putting on our environmental health vehicles and such to let the public know about the air quality and folks who may have asthma and other chronic lung diseases. So this has no match requirements, a straight grant for the $1,300. So we'd appreciate your support in accepting the funding.
Your motion?
I'll make the motion.
Second.
And second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it. Yes, ma'am.
Can I ask a question? Have you seen an increase in asthma cases in the last few years or X number of years?
It's probably maybe a little bit, basically because we have more sensitive testing and doctors are able to diagnose asthma a bit more. There's certainly a lot of different causes out in the environment for asthma and trigger asthma. I think it's basically that we just have more sensitivity, more testing, and the availability to diagnose it better with the technology now.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Thanks. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Okay, next is County Manager reports. He's going to give us the report on the contract with the Chamber of Commerce.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I also have two additional items after this, so I didn't want to forget those as well. With respect to the Chamber contract, this was an item that was tabled from our last meeting. As the Board is aware, we do not have a formal contract with the Chamber to provide for economic development services. The only thing that we can find with respect to any agreement are minutes that were approved setting out the parameters of duties and responsibilities that were approved in 1986. Attached in your agenda packet is a proposed contract that has been approved by the Chamber Board. This basically spells out what they have been doing and what they are doing now, but in a more formal document. We did make one minor change as we discussed at our last meeting. That was in Section 9 on the contract termination. The termination notice has been changed from 180 days to 90 days. And also we have Mac Williams and Derek Steed with the Chamber here tonight if there are any questions or concerns that you have.
Does the Board have any questions?
Yeah, okay. I do. As far as the contract is concerned, if you could...
When he comes up here,
agree to tweak it somewhat, if the Board agrees to what I have to say. My feeling is that the report should be made to the Board regarding county finances and not just between the county manager and the president. And that's just one of them. Monthly reports to the Board. All communications between the county and chamber includes Board members. And you were talking about two full seats on y'all's board, and you said there would be two government people on that. I certainly think that one of them should be a commissioner.
I am on that board. I'm on the Economic Development Board. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
As a point of clarification, first let me introduce myself for the viewing audience, if you will. I'm Mac Williams, president of the chamber. I think what you're referring to is we have a Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors, and we also have an Economic Development Committee. Right now, we have two representatives of the county and other public sector agencies that each have two members on the Economic Development Committee, and we have that committee meets on a quarterly basis to discuss and talk about the things that are going on in that economic development arena. What you may be referring to is seats on the chamber board.
Or economic development. Because we're not getting, as a board, we're not getting any information back. And I really honestly think that we should have some information coming back to this board.
As I said, we are reporting on what's going on in the economic development arena on a quarterly basis at the meetings, and Linda, Tim has come, Craig has come, It's up to this group to decide who your representatives are going to be, and then to attend the meetings. And so,
that report is being given
to representatives from the funding agencies, including the private sector side, and we also have some representatives from the school system, the airport authority, and other agencies and entities at the community college that are partners in our efforts to do economic development. So we are doing that reporting to that group. What they do with it back to their groups, I mean, they're the representative. What they do with it back to their groups, I guess, is up to them.
Well, that seems to be some slip in communication coming back to this board. Okay. This is a point I wanted to make.
I have given those out in the weekly updates. There was a chamber meeting a couple of weeks ago that I was unable to attend, one of the quarterly meetings. So,
what we're proposing in this is to formalize the process where the county manager receives a report from me, who he in turn would share with you. Unedited.
Right.
what I would give to him, he would pass along to you. So this formalizes a more frequent reporting process, at least between the two of us.
Because it's never been done before.
And Craig had started doing that.
That's correct.
Exactly. Because Craig gives us that information.
We're perfectly comfortable and fine with doing that.
So we're doing it now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Do we need to have it in the contract?
It is in the contract.
Services. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm just, you know, trying to make the point that it comes to the board and the board knows about it. What's going on?
Happy to do that.
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else got any questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion to accept this service.
I'd like to make a statement here before we vote.
Okay.
I intend on voting no on this contract. I want it clear as to why. I was going to vote yes. I don't want you to know that. I don't want your board to know that. And then I pick up, well, I hear about it Friday afternoon, and then I pick up Saturday's paper and see where you were making references that I was in part responsible for Microsoft going to Virginia. And in my opinion, that's the most absurd comment I've ever heard coming from a professional person. You can't substantiate, number one. Number two, this commissioner never made a reference to Microsoft, about Microsoft, period. You can't show that I ever did. And number three, if a person in government can't speak out about how they intend on voting generically about these processes, we're losing a lot about what I thought this country was all about. I don't have a lot of respect for business when it stabs in the back, when it puts profit over principle. I've been there. I've seen the blinders that people have when it comes to certain involvements. Bankers, and so forth and so on. I'm not saying everybody's in that league, but I resented those comments, whether they were generic or whether they were specific, to tie me to that business venture. Going to the state of Virginia versus coming here, I think is trivial, I think is immature, and I think it's sour grapes, and I think it's personal, and I mean that. After the vote, I would like to continue this discussion with something definitely germane to the item on the agenda.
You have any comment?
I may respond, if I may.
Go ahead.
All right. Friday evening, after I also saw the story, I called you. And I called you and I said to you that when I responded to the question from Mr. Boyer here, why did they not pick Alamance, your name was never mentioned. The person that introduced your name into that conversation was Mr. Boyer, not me.
Did you acknowledge any reference back towards that inquiry?
We then went on to a more general conversation about your comments about anti-incentive comments. I think those were referred to be. But he asked me about to respond to that question. I did not bring your name up as a reason why Microsoft. It wasn't asked of me. We just expanded more broadly on the idea of what goes on in that process. I have no issue with your taking a statement on a public policy and whether or not you agree with it or want to expand on it, given your philosophies. That is your right and your privilege. And I think you do so sincerely out of your instinct and desire to do what you think is the best for Alamance County citizens. Interestingly enough, one other thing I would say to you, in that article, I think it would be worth noting that nowhere within quotes did I say Tim Sutton is responsible for the company not coming to Alamance. That's not a quote that I made or was attributed to me in the story. It is, in my view, in my opinion, an extrapolation and an interpretation by the reporter here on what he said. It was in the context that started out as a conversation about the company, but my intent and my comment had nothing to do specifically with you being the reason. There were lots of other much bigger reasons why that decision was made on the behalf of the company, but it wasn't about what you said.
But to paraphrase,
I told you that on Friday night, and I told your fellow commissioners that, I've told my board that, I've told everybody that my intent and my comment did not have anything to do with you. In response to the question from the reporter, why did they go somewhere else? Your name was not mentioned by me. He brought your name into the conversation. I did not. But I did respond in general to questions about the effect your comments have on the process.
It doesn't matter who started it, it's who ended it or who continued it. Now, did you paraphrase, can you paraphrase, or can we paraphrase that you said my comments weren't helpful?
That is an accurate statement.
Okay. Well, see,
not in reference to Microsoft.
I disagree with you on those assumptions. And it's sad that we can't be more professional in this relationship.
Can we go on with, can we go ahead and get this done?
If I'm through, I'll say yes. I'm through. Well, for now.
Okay, we need to get back to the business at hand. Do I hear a motion that we accept the service contract annual renewal, which is the first, evidently? So I'll entertain a motion.
I will make that motion.
I have a motion on the floor.
I'll second.
I have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Now, in relation to the topic that's germane to the item on the agenda, the contract's there. It's in place. I have no problem with that. Majority won. But I would ask that our board become more informed about the processes in the state of North Carolina as far as business recruiting. If you don't already, call the County Commissioner Association today, and they gave me a website called North Carolina Economic Development. The website is County Manager's Guide. But it shows a whole list of counties and cities that do not have relationships directly with the Chamber of Commerce in regards to economic development. Just a whole list of them. I called two of them, two out of two, gave me this report. Randolph County split away from the Chamber of Commerce in 1985. And they have Randolph County Economic Development Corporation, and according to what I was told, they get contributions from the county and all the municipalities, and they have separate boards. And the same answer came from Cabarrus. Cabarrus separated from the Chamber of Commerce in 2005. Different boards, same contribution process, as well as private people can donate and so forth and so on. And both of them gave me some type of analogy that politics was involved a lot when you deal with the chambers. and that they felt like to be separate, that it was more business-like and not as political. Now, I can't swear that's the truth, but I would request that over the next few months that our county management team do some type of analogy of the two different processes or what other processes that are available to us rather than having a contract with the Chamber of Commerce. I see nothing wrong with trying to gain more information as I did today. So,
Mr. Sutton, just for a reply to that, there is the Piedmont Triad Partnership, as you are aware of, that we do not give enough money for us to have anybody on that board. It requires $25,000 a year. I do go to the quarterly meetings for that as well, and I meet, and most of the people on there are businessmen. There are only two counties that pay the $25,000 to have somebody on that Piedmont Triad Partnership Board, which that's what their job is to go out and look for businesses to come in to North Carolina and in our area, and it's the Piedmont Triad. And the only two counties that are in that are Guilford and Forsyth. So we can't pay the $25,000. So as what I think and how I feel about it, there's 12 other counties that do not pay this $25,000. And we have one member out of those 12 that is, I think it's 12, is it not 12, Craig?
I believe.
I think so. Anyway, I meet again this month. I've only been twice because I've last year, we were not allowed to even be on that board or anybody. Burlington was on it, and now this year, I'm on it. But I just want to say that with respect to the fact that we don't have anybody else looking for us, because you know who's going to get those jobs. It's going to be Guilford County and Forsyth County, because they pay the big bucks to be in that. So I do go, and if anybody's got any questions that they want me to ask when I go, I'll be glad to entertain them and take them with me. But I just wanted to make that known to everybody that we don't have anybody else to help us.
I realize that, and yeah. All I'm saying is let's see if there's maybe a better avenue to pursue.
We want to pay $25,000, so.
Well, you wouldn't have to necessarily be a member of Piedmont Triad. You could set up just like Randolph County, Cabarrus. I'm just saying.
Okay. There's I don't have a problem with looking at any of that. You know
I'd like
that.
To see.
Okay.
What the success.
We'll look at it.
And what their budgets are, and so forth, and see and if it might be viable here.
Okay.
We're paying a whole lot more than that in the chamber.
Well, that's true, but. We need to pay both of them if we're going to do that. It's my opinion. But anyway, at this time, does anybody want to pull anything from the
Just want to get a clarification.
I'm sorry, you got two more things.
Oh, I do. I got a couple more, okay, more things. Okay. But with respect to Commissioner Sutton's request, I want to make sure I'm clear what the board is wanting me to do. Would you like me to research what other counties are doing with respect to economic development as far as bringing it in-house? Do they contract with others? Do they do it on a regional basis? What are other options we can do other than the chamber? I think that is the gist of what Commissioner Sutton said, is that look at budgets, look at staffing. Is that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't have a problem with it.
That's fine. Look at it.
If that's if the board, I don't have a problem with
it. We will try to find you something and bring a report back to you by January 1, so that will give you 6 months to make a decision. Is that a good time frame for this?
Yeah, there's no rush. I just like to see it kind of in a timely fashion, where when the contract comes up again, and or you know, after 90 days, you know, we can review it. I mean, nothing's infinite.
And I think I have talked with Mr. Williams, and he's you know, I asked you if you would get that information from me about what jobs the chamber has brought in, and when you have it. Do you have copies for everybody?
Yes, I do.
Very good.
If you could present that. I had asked Mac for this. What role the chamber played in?
The projects that have come into the county.
Thank you, Mac.
This is from 2005 to today. And this information was information that, I'm sorry, yes, here we go, Thomas.
And our county attorney.
This information was compiled by us, and it is information that was created at the time that the public information was available to be disseminated. In other words, at the time of the announcement. This is not a report of what's currently in place. It's a report of what was announced at the time the project came in, as best we could determine. Not every one of these did we have an involvement with. Some of these just happened on their own. And so where we have an asterisk, that indicates that we had some level of involvement with them. It could have been just simply working to provide information. It could have been managing the incentives process. It could be all of that. And so so I've tried to show where we have had some value add, if you will, to the process on all the projects that we know of. And again, a lot of these are companies that were already here and just did some expanding on their own. And we read about it, you know, in the paper or were made aware of it. And others, we were specifically involved in the recruitment process, involving, in some cases, the incentives process.
Thank you, Matt.
All right.
Okay, Mr. Hunnicutt.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In front of you is a letter that, with your approval, that we will send to our LME. As the board is aware, staff has been working with the LME to find a new partner to merge with. We have a deadline that we've been given by the State Department of Mental Health to look at a merger by July 1 of next year. We have deadlines that they have also set. We've missed that first deadline, but we have an October 1 deadline coming up to identify a partner. Kevin Howard, who is the Caswell County Manager, and I have met with Dan's staff, but we've also been meeting with CenterPoint. We've met with OPC. We've met with Sandhills. And we've also met with the Guilford Center and looking to see who would be a good fit for Alamance County for mental health services. And what Kevin and I would like to do with our both boards' approval is to send a letter to the LME and say that, you know, going through the process, that we would like to recommend that either the LME board choose OPC, which is Orange, Pierce, and Chatham, or CenterPoint, which is Forsyth, Rockingham, Stokes, and Davie as our partner to be merged with for the LME. You know, as the board is aware, as of January or February of 2009, the Rockingham County removed from the Alamance Caswell Rockingham LME. Therefore, our numbers fell below what the state said is an LME. And we have been looking at trying to find a new partner. The state has now given us specific deadlines and benchmarks that they would like us to meet. And with this board's approval, we would, you know, Kevin and I, you know, would like to send this letter jointly and saying that, you know, these are two that we feel like would be well suited for us to merge with.
And if you would just tell them the state will take 10% of the money that we have been getting each year that we don't merge with.
The state is taking 10% of the money this year.
That's an LME. I just wanted that number.
The state has basically mandated that we merge with somebody as of July 1 of next year. But we, again, attached the state's letter where they gave us the benchmarks and the time frame.
Do we make that choice, or does the state make it for us?
We make the choice. You know, this board will make the final choice and the final say-so, but going through the process, you know, the council manager and myself, we both kind of felt like that either CenterPoint or OPC were better fits, you know, and let the LME board choose which one they feel like is best. But in looking at overall service providing and service delivery and continuity of services, these were better fit for us than Sandhills or the Guilford Center.
Yeah. Either one's close. I don't have a problem with either one of
them. I think Rockingham went with CenterPoint, did they not?
Yes, ma'am, they did.
Rockingham went with CenterPoint on this. And I did meet with OPC prior to. at one point, and but I have not met with Center Point.
Yes, ma'am. If there's no problem with the board, this will be a joint letter we do send from the council manager and myself. But wanted to make you aware of it.
Okay. Is everybody in consent with this? I don't think we need to make a motion on it. So. No. Everybody? Okay.
One other thing. In front of you, you have a resolution approving financing agreement and deed of trust information from our bond attorney. This is for the Career and Tech building that we have already approved. We're looking at closing, I believe, Friday.
Next Wednesday.
The 15th. And there's minor changes that our attorney has seen in the closing documents that we need to incorporate. Todd, do you want to?
There are just a few minor changes that Mr. Aspen wants to make. We have had difficulty getting up with a bank's attorney over the holiday weekend. So that's why we bring it to you tonight, to let you know that we are getting to the end of this. We have a pre-closing on Friday, and hopefully everything will go smoothly, and then we'll close the transaction on Wednesday.
Okay.
This will not change the terms or the length or anything like that, just some minor internal dealings with the bond attorneys and the final agreements on the document.
Okay. Do I need a motion? Or?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, do I hear a motion we accept this change?
So,
I have a motion on the floor. A second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Okay. Thank you. You got anything else, sir? Mr. Hunnicutt.
Oh, I'm finally finished.
Okay. Okay. Does anyone want to pull anything from the consent agenda?
Minutes.
What?
Minutes.
I'm sorry. Which
no,
one?
Just that regular meeting. I did ask for something to be attached to the minutes, and it's not mentioned here. I kind of felt like it should be.
I don't remember what it was.
That was the question that I started asking Clyde because of the paperwork that I had received. And then there was an interruption during that whole process. Didn't get through. But I asked that be attached to the minutes, and y'all said it was okay.
The letters that I sent you?
All the,
got
that big pack of letters.
Yeah, I got my copy in my
bag. Yeah, but it was just that one specific area that I was asking about. And y'all said it was okay. It's not mentioned on here in the minutes.
Well, we can add it to it. Yeah. Okay.
Please.
You can amend it.
Sure. If Ms. Jones will fix it. Okay.
She can fix it.
Mm-hmm. I can't remember exactly what was said.
I don't know what letter it is either. Do you know what letter it was in?
It was the correspondence from the department. Of
yeah, the ones that I put in our package.
Okay.
That's fine.
I thought that's money. Why they were in our package, that response from.
Was to that.
Yeah.
Request.
Yeah.
Is that all?
Yeah, that's as far as she's okay. concerned.
Okay. All right, so then do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda other than the amendment to the minutes?
Move.
Have a motion?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed? Commissioners' comments. Anybody have any commissioners' comments?
Yeah, I do.
Go right ahead.
Let Tim go first this time.
Two things. This was in front of my seat when I sat down. Solicitation for a vote for the sales tax in Pitt County. And I approached the county manager about putting this in front of us. Would he be as eager to put some opposing solicitations with the same vigor these seem to have gotten here? And he said, well, he didn't do it. He said, Mr. Boswell did it. So I'd like to ask, what was the purpose of this?
I was just curious as what other counties had done on this 0.25 cent, because it seems to be passing a number of counties now. And what are they doing with that 0.25 cent that they're taking in?
16.
And to so the citizens know, we're not just going to tack on an extra tax.
We're not?
No. They're gonna make that decision, Tim. I don't know if you're afraid of it or not.
No, sir, then you're going to vote. Then you're going to approve it. If it goes on.
I'm not going to vote to approve it.
Is that not correct?
Right now.
Wouldn't you have to approve it?
That's the process.
We do have to.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the process.
So if you voted for it,
well, we have to enact it.
You have to.
And I think I know the voters of Alamance County. Voters of Alamance County is not going to add any more taxes, I hope. I hope the people in Alamance County are that smart.
Well, this,
and I think they are.
This came from the annual association of county commissioners.
Yeah, I did ask.
And I was there for
see
that
what other
last counties, week.
What they're doing with it.
And this was part of the process in one of the meetings, and I was in it. I didn't know it was going to be here tonight.
I mean, we did go last budget without adding a couple ambulance that we really could use.
We could cut a whole lot of stuff.
If you privatize the non-emergency, you can cut out some ambulances. Well, I would just say to you, I would just say to you that, you know, there's a lot of groups out here who are pro-taxation and pro-raising of taxes, and they do organize, and they do these little campaigns, and I hope that there's going to be some people who organize to not do it. But if not, I think the voters will have their say.
That's it. And that's the best part about
that's
the whole
right.
thing.
And I have a comment here, a further comment about Mr. Blair. I'm going to ask the county attorney a question that I had here. I wrote it down before you spoke, and it was DOJ suit for Arizona. And I hope you'll enjoy my question, because it is a sincere question. But I remember now vividly what I said August 16th. Might not be verbatim, but it's going to be darn close. I said, I respect the DOJ, Department of Justice. I said, I respect them. I said, but I don't respect not having a checks and balances system of how you respond to any governmental agency. I guarantee you that's the tone of my comment. And how you can get that into resist shows how twisted debate will become if unchallenged. So with that said, as far as you're concerned, years ago I used to work for an agency, for a financial institution in Greensboro. Internal Revenue came in, wanted to see a man's file because he was had some questionable financial dealings. And they came in, just walked in and said, you know, we're the Internal Revenue. We want to see this man's file. And my manager, being the professional that he was, and didn't blink often to bluffs, he said, show me your warrant. I'm not pulling anybody's file out of here without a warrant. They left. They never came back as far as I know. But they would have definitely looked at that file had we pulled it. Okay. Number two, I worked at another, well, same company. And we've gone to great lengths to repossess two luxury cars. And we had them fixed to where they couldn't be towed off our lot and so forth and so on, because we knew that Internal Revenue was wanting those cars. And they walked in our front door and said, we want the keys to those two cars. And we'd busted our butts to find them, to store them, put them to where they couldn't be towed off for a lot, short of moving a building. And our manager said, another manager said, no. And they opened up their coats. Well, first they left, walked outside, came back in our front door, opened up their coats and showed us they were armed. And our boss threw them the keys. The guy that was with them was a friend of mine. He told me later, he said, Tim, we'd have never took those cars. He said, if your boss would have just said, show us your papers, you know, show us the court orders. But said, he knuckled in. Said, we'd have never took them. Said, that was a bluff. With that said, there's got to be checks and balances, and people not afraid to have those checks and balances. And I'm sure that's what that DVD is going to show. But I had on here to ask Clyde about the attorney, the suit down in Arizona. You know, you're familiar with, they've been sued. Right. Are we doing anything similar than what, you know, to what Arizona was doing that might provoke the same action? Not that I'd be afraid to say sue us. I said, not be afraid, not to do it. Are we doing anything that might be similar to what Arizona's doing that caused their suit?
The pattern seems to be similar with the Department of Justice and the way they conduct these investigations under Section 14141 of the statute. And we've provided the documentations. I believe the Arizona Sheriff's Office provided about 400,000 pages of documentation. And it's taken a year for them to bring suit against Arizona. Arizona's right on the border, so they have a lot bigger issues with immigration than Alamance County. So I think there is a pattern with the Department of Justice in the way they conduct their investigations, but there are some similarities. Just not magnitude. Just not the magnitude that you find in Arizona.
So you think possibly that lawsuit is more symbolic than it is on the government's part?
I don't know the sheriff out there. I haven't looked at his records. I have looked at ours, and I know our sheriff. And I've spent weeks over there with the chief deputy, and I have not found any evidence of a pattern and practice of discrimination. So that's why I can say with confidence, and as far as our sheriff and our documents are concerned, I think we're going to be fine.
Are you through?
Are you looking at me?
Are you through?
Yes, ma'am. I am through.
Yeah, Ms. Bob, you have a turn. Go ahead, Ms. Bob.
Unless somebody approaches me outside, then I might not be through.
Several weeks ago, I asked for a copy of the contract we have with Sam Langford out of Greensboro with the security system over at the courthouse. Do you have that?
I do not have a copy of that. I have looked. I've looked at storage for that. I do not have a copy of the legal documents. And I believe that finance has looked as well.
So there's no contract? Again?
Well,
no contract.
Wow. I think there is a contract.
I think so.
Invoices are being generated and checks are being cashed.
Mm-hmm.
But we can't get our hands on it. So I can't explain what's happening.
Well, they should have a copy of it, too.
They should.
We have asked. They do not. They have a template contract that they use for most everybody, and we're waiting on getting that copy. You know, I don't know if it's the exact contract which the board approved, but it's the template of what they used with other their other government agencies.
How long has that been since that was approved?
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask. How long have we... Has it been since we contracted with them? In fact, the sheriff may know that.
3 years?
What? About 3 years ago, the county decided to contract with them and hire private security to handle the courthouse. We had nothing to do with the negotiations or the contract.
That's been 3 years, huh?
Yeah, that's separate from y'all's
contract. It's been a long time. I remember it coming up, but I don't remember the details.
Well, did y'all approve it?
Oh yeah.
We approved it.
Want to see the contract?
It was cheaper than what we could hire them and do it ourselves.
Should that not be in the minutes from back then and know what the contract said?
That should be a copy somewhere.
The shouldas and the couldas and the wouldas. I don't know.
We're still, as soon as we can get that draft template of what they've used, we'll be sure to get it before. But we have asked.
Okay,
that's great.
Okay, I'll also ask for a listing of lawsuits and/or executive hearings,
I do
about.
I have those in my office. I was sick a couple of days last week.
That's not allowed, Craig.
I do apologize. I was sick a couple of days last week. Well, we do have that information.
We do have that. Okay, and then the last thing, I think this is going to go to Clyde, and that was with that packet that was sent to us.
Right. By the Department of Justice?
Yeah, and where they list four questions, and I just want your reaction to them.
Well,
four statements.
The four statements that they have there?
Yeah.
I am more interested in what they find in the documentation, engaging in a series of letters, which seems to be their pattern, one letter following another letter following another letter. And so I have asked them to contact me after they have reviewed the documents and have a report as to what they found. And they received all the documents Tuesday morning, last Tuesday morning.
Oh, 90 million of them.
Haven't heard anything from them, so I assume that they're going through them and will report to us.
Okay. Any other comments?
I'm going to make one about Graham's having their September 11th celebration down here just for the everybody here. They're going to start at noon. It's going to be a nice event, I think.
Any announcements up here? That was an announcement.
Okay.
Okay. If not, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.